In this video, I am showing how to use a yellow hat to build a CTC panel with two button route selection and activation, route status display, and route monitoring while the train is moving to the destination track. And even though it might look like magic, it is pure logic. Welcome to the IoTT channel, I am Hans Tanner. Here is the list of features I want to have on my CTC panel. Routes can be selected by pressing on two buttons. First, hold down the destination button, then click on the origin button and the route gets activated. Alternatively, routes can be selected from a handheld throttle using a switch address assigned to a route and set it to closed. If a route is activated, it should be displayed on the CTC panel with green track indicator LEDs. While the train is moving from block to block on an active route, the track indicator LEDs should change to red. The route integrity must be constantly monitored. If a switch that is part of the route changes position, the route is cancelled. The route also should be cleared automatically if the train reaches the destination track. It should be possible to set the panel to remote mode. In this case, all input buttons are disabled and only the track indicator LEDs are working to display route statuses and block occupancy. And finally, as a safety measure, it should not be possible to set a route if the destination track is occupied by a train. From a technical point of view, a CTC panel is one big status machine that reacts to external events like button activations and track occupancy or switch position changes. So it is another implementation of the if this, then that mechanism explained in video number 62. And therefore, it should be possible to build it using the functionality provided by the IoTT Stix event handler. First, a quick look at the hardware. I am still using my simple test layout with three train stations and two tracks in each station. The track is cut into blocks, which are supplied from two BDL168 block detectors that report occupancy statuses to LocoNet. As CTC panel, I am using the picture frame CTC panel built in video number 9. This CTC panel was really the first implementation of the yellow hat concept, and at that time the control circuitry was called the yellow box hardware. So here's the conceptual layout. Two BDL168s feeding track occupancy information to LocoNet. A yellow hat on the backside of the CTC panel and the 10 input buttons and the 109 track indicator LEDs connected to it. Four of the input buttons are used to toggle individual turnouts and six of them are located next to the track graphics so that they can be used for route selection. The IoTT stick with the built-in event handler is running the logic of the CTC panel, including all the requirements for route management. At least that's what it should be. In my case, there is a slight modification. If you watched video number 9, you know that I used touch buttons on the original picture frame CTC panel, and I'm still using them. Unfortunately, touch buttons was the only feature of the original yellow box that I was not able to support with the IoTT stick, so it is not available on the yellow hat. On the other hand, the software of the IoTT stick has come a long way in the meantime, and therefore the event handler and also the LED chain support of the old yellow box hardware cannot support all features I am going to show here. So for this video, I decided to use the old yellow box hardware just to drive the touch buttons on the panel and send that information to the IoTT stick and yellow hat that drives the panel logic and the LED chain of the CTC panel. And since I am not using the input buttons of the yellow hat, I later even replaced the yellow hat with a blue hat, which only supports the LED chain. Despite those changes though, the configuration of the event handler and the LED chain remains the same, thanks to the modular concept. The stick does not care whether it operates on a blue hat or a yellow hat. As mentioned, a CTC panel is basically a status machine, and to make it work, it needs to have these functions. First, we need to identify the route that needs to be set based on the button input. Every route gets assigned a switch number, so once it is known what route to set, all we need to do is issue a switch command. This approach has the big advantage that routes can also be controlled from any other LocalNet device, for example a handheld throttle or a computer running JMRI. Next, we need to do a safety check. What I do in this example is verification that the destination track is not occupied by another train. If it is, the route request will be declined. If everything is good, the commands for the turnouts that are part of the route are generated. So when the route is set, we have all turnouts in the correct position and the route switch set to closed, indicating that the route is set. As a result of this activity, the route display on the CTC panel is updated, showing the active route using green track indicator LEDs. Now we need to monitor the route to verify that it is still valid. I basically monitor for two conditions that would clear the route. If any of the switches of the route changes position, the route becomes invalid and the route reservation must be cleared. That's my turnout position watcher. And if the train reaches the destination track, the route must be cleared as well, as it is no longer needed. This is what the train movement completion watcher does. If any of these watcher events triggers, the route is cleared by changing the route switch from closed to thrown, indicating that the route is no longer valid. And as a result of this event, the CTC panel display is updated and the route is no longer showing a set status. So that's the overall functionality. Now let's have a look into how this can be implemented on the IoT T-Stick. To get started, I do a first implementation of the LED chain so that the panel starts to display switch positions and track occupancy. For the moment, I do that the very simple way, just showing track occupancy. Later on, I will change that to support route status display as well. Following the LED assignment table, I set an entry for each block detector showing the associated LEDs. Yellow if the block is occupied and dark if it is free. Then I set the turnout position LEDs on the track display and next to the toggle buttons to indicate the active direction in red. Finally, I add an entry for the power status LED and one for the remote status LED. As you see, I plan to use switch number 200 to switch the remote mode of the panel on and off. A click on save and restart writes the data into the stick, and after rebooting, my track indicators and turnout position indicators are working. I run a train across the track and use a handheld throttle to change turnout position. All indicator LEDs seem to work as intended, and I can move on to setting up the event handlers. Just as a warm-up activity, so to speak, I configured the four buttons to set individual turnouts, so buttons 141 to 144. First, I create an event handler entry for button 141. On the then that side, I create a single command that just toggles switch number 3 every time the button is down. The other switch events of the button are not used. Only toggle the switch when the button down event occurs. Note that with the latest version of the IoT T-Stick software, you have the choice between regular switch commands and the switch acknowledge command, which also works if the Bushby bit in the command station is set. So by selecting the switch command, you can define the priority the panel is going to have in your system, if you make use of the Bushby bit feature. Another new feature of the latest stick software which as usual can be downloaded from the GitHub, is the enable function for each event. I make use of it to block the input buttons when the CTC panel is in remote control mode. All I need to do is set enable to switch 200 closed, and the button will only take commands if switch 200 is in that position. If it is in the thrown position, the remote LED on the panel shows blue and the button inputs are disabled. I then create copies of the first event handler, change the addresses of the button and the target switch, click save and restart, and the turnout buttons on the CTC panel are working. When I click the button, the switch changes position and the indicator LEDs adjust accordingly. I also can send a switch 200 thrown command and the blue remote LED comes on and the buttons are no longer working, just as intended. Now let's move on to the more interesting stuff. First, the route setting function, which is pretty simple. Every time when it receives a closed command for the switch address that the route is assigned to, it executes a list of switch commands to set the turnouts. So as shown in this table, if I want to set a route to go from track 11 to track 21, I would issue a closed command for switch number 100, and the route generator would then set turnouts 3 and 2 to closed in this case. If I wanted to go to track 22 instead, I would issue a closed command to switch 104, and the route generator would issue switch commands to set turnout 3 to closed and turnout 2 to thrown. At the end of this process, the turnouts are set to the correct position and the route switch is set to closed, indicating that the route is set. To set this up, I create an event handler for every route, so a total of 16 event handlers. But fortunately, most of it can just be copied, so I set up the first one for route switch number 100. The command list for the thrown position remains empty, as I only want to set the route when the closed command occurs. The closed command has two entries, one to set switch number 3 to closed and the other to do the same for switch number 2. The enable function I set to block detector 03, which means the event will only trigger if the destination track of the route is not occupied. If another train is in the block section, the route command will be declined. I then copy the entry 15 times and change the switch numbers according to my route table, and that's the route generator function. The next step is monitoring the turnout positions and clearing the routes if a change that would break the route occurs. This is really simple. All I need to do is monitoring switch commands and clear the route switch accordingly. So for example, when switch 3 turns to closed, that would break routes number 102, 106, 113 and 115. So my event handler sets the route switches of these routes to thrown. So I create one event handler for every switch, and in the command lists for closed and thrown, I just set the route switch of each affected route to thrown, indicating that the route is no longer active. Note that I send these commands every time the switch position is changed, regardless whether the corresponding route is set or not. Also note that these route handlers are always active. So these are the four event handlers that make my turnout watcher functionality. The train movement watcher works similar. It clears the route when the block detector of the destination track shows occupied. For the routes, I have a total of 6 destination tracks, as shown in this table. And for each track, I can list the routes that lead to that destination. So I create 6 more event handlers that monitor the block detector of each block and change the route switch to thrown, indicating that the train has arrived and the route can be cleared. Again, I create the first one, then copy it 5 times and change the addresses. So by now we can set the routes using a switch address and we can monitor and clear them either as a result of changing turnout or a train arriving at the destination. What is missing is the two-button route selection and the display of the route status on the CTC panel. Let's get started with that, as it is probably the most complex setup of the entire panel. The reason is that the display is a function of two different inputs, the route status and the occupancy status. And the second problem is that the same LED needs to show the route status of four different routes. So it is time for a little hat trick. Regarding the LED chain setup, we know that it is possible to show several colors on the same LED. We have done that, for example, with multi-aspect signals. Furthermore, it is possible to make the output a function of more than one input variable, as long as they are all of the same type. In video number 69, for example, we made the aspect output a function of the combination of two block sensors to change the signal aspect from stop to slow to track speed. So what we need to do is changing the route switch information to block detector messages. Then we can combine them with the input from the BDL-168 block detectors and display route and track status at the same time on the same LED. So first I dedicate 6 block detector addresses from 100 to 105 to serve as proxies for the route statuses. As you see, I do not need a proxy address for every real block detector, but I can group together the areas that are always active at the same time. For example, if I set route 100, which sets a route to go from track 11 to track 21, I need to activate block detectors 102 and 103. Block detector 100 is not activated in this case, as this is the origin of the route. If I set route 102 from track 12 to track 21, it turns out that I need to activate the same block detectors as everything but the origin is the same. So I can combine those two things together. Doing so for all other routes results in the two tables shown here, and I can go ahead and set up an event handler for each line. First, I define an event that listens to the switch events, 100 and 102 in the first example. If both of these switches are thrown, meaning none of the routes is set, I set block detectors 102 and 103 to free. And in the other three cases, meaning at least one of the input switches is closed and the route going through the blocks is active, I set block detectors 102 and 103 to occupied. Now there is a little extra trick, as I want the route only to be set if the target track is free, but on the other hand I want it to be cleared in any case. Since I cannot assign the enable function to only some of the input statuses, I have to define two event handler entries. The first one is only active if the block detector of the destination track is free and has the command lists for when at least one of the switches is closed. The second entry is always on and has the command list for when both switches are thrown, meaning no route is active and the combined block detectors are set to free. Again, I copy that for each line of the table and change the addresses accordingly. Then I click Save and Restart to write the information to the stick. With that completed, I can now set up the LEDs. I show this using the example of track 21, which is a combination of block detectors 0, which has the occupancy status, and block detector 103, which indicates that the block is reserved by a route. In the LED chain, I set this up for the three LED numbers 93, 95 and 97. If both block detectors are free, the LED is set to dark. If the block is occupied with no route set, the color is yellow. If a route is set but the block not occupied, the color is set to green, and if the block is occupied and the route is set, the LED comes up red. Again, I repeat the setup for all other LEDs according to the tables, and that's it for the LEDs. The last missing part is setting up the two-button input for route selection. For that, I go back to the event handler. Settings for two-button input is always done as a pair of event handlers, one for each button that is part of the input. Let's look into the example of buttons 171 and 178, so the track location buttons for track 11 and 21, and either origin or destination for routes 100 and 109. Which route is selected depends on the sequence of which button is pressed first. The way I set it up, the first button I press indicates the destination and the second the origin track. But that is just my convention. You can do it the other way around if you prefer. So in the event handler I create two entries, one for button 171 and one for buttons 178. When I select the button down event, I get a field where I can enter the address of the counterpart, so 178 for button 171 and vice versa. This is actually the button that needs to be held down when clicking the second button to trigger the event. So line 47 here means to trigger this event, hold down button 171, then press button 178, and the command list to the right is executed. Hence, route switch 100 is set to close, which then will activate the route as we have seen earlier. Line 48 is for the reverse sequence, and therefore route switch 109 is activated. And since I don't want these buttons to work when the panel is in remote mode, I set the enable function to switch 200 closed so that it works the same way as we have seen for the other buttons. Again, I copy the setup for all the other route pairs and change the addresses, and that's it. I click save and restart, and the CTC panel is operational, so let's do some testing. First, I hold the destination button for track 22 and then click the button of track 12. I see switches 2 and 3 change to the thrown position, and then the track indicator LED is turning green, indicating that the route is set. I now move the train and see the track indicators changing to red as the train moves through the blocks. When the destination block is reached, the route is cleared and only the occupancy indicator of track 22 remains on to indicate the block is occupied. Next, I repeat the process to go from track 22 to track 31. Again, I see the turnouts going into position and the indicator LEDs turning green and then red as I move the locomotives. Once I reach track 31, the route is cleared. I do it again to go from track 31 to track 21, and it works as seen before. My next test is verifying the safety mechanism. With track 21 occupied, I try to activate a route going from track 12 to track 21, and one going from track 32 to 21. I see the button messages flowing in the LocoNet viewer, but nothing happens because track 21 is occupied. Now I repeat the process for a route going from track 12 to track 22 instead, and as expected, the route is activated. So the safety feature works. Now I manually change switch number 3 from thrown to closed, and the active route is cleared as it became invalid. It does not matter, by the way, whether I send that switch command from the control panel button or a handheld throttle. The route is cleared in either way because also the panel button is just sending a LocoNet command from the event handler. That's the advantage of a peer-to-peer network like LocoNet. Every network node gets the same information. So it looks like all the tests were successful and the panel works as designed. So let's summarize. A CTC panel is basically a status machine that turns events like sensor inputs and button inputs into action, using the if this, then that model. To make it work, we need to have functions to set a route, monitor a route, and clear a route if it is no longer valid. All these functions can be implemented in the event handler of the IoT T-Stick. The 16 routes on my CTC panel needed a total of 62 event handlers. That includes 20 handlers for just monitoring the input button activity and 16 for display purposes. When setting up several routes, it is a good idea to use tables to make note of the assigned addresses, and using ranges of consecutive addresses facilitates the work, as creating copies of event handlers is easier to do. The next step now is to add signals to the system. That's what I plan to do in the next video, and if you don't want to miss it, you should subscribe to the IoTT channel and hit the bell icon so that you are in a premium seat when that video comes out. And that's it for today. I hope this information was useful or at least interesting for you, and you have a better idea about what the event handler of the IoTT stick can do to automate your model railroad layout without using a computer. And if you want to experiment with that setup for yourself, you can download the event handler and LED chain setup data used in this example from the config data section of my GitHub page and load it into your IoTT stick. Thanks for watching and see you in the next video.